praise. Be exalted, O Lord my God, Hosanna in the highest. Glory, glory, glory to the King of Kings. Glory, glory, glory to the King of Kings. Lord, we lift up your name with hearts full of praise. Be exalted, O Lord my God. Glory to the King of Kings. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Lord, we lift up your name with hearts full of praise. Be exalted, O Lord my God, Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Lord, we lift up your name with hearts full of praise. Be exalted, O Lord my God, Hosanna in the highest. Lord, we lift up your name with hearts full of praise. Be exalted, O Lord my God, Hosanna in the highest. Be exalted, O Lord my God, Hosanna in the highest. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me, bless his holy name. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me, bless. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me, bless his holy name. He has done great things. He has done great things. He has done great things. Bless his holy name. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. Bless his holy name. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me, bless his holy name. Bless his holy. Be not dismayed, whatever betide, God will take care of you. And you can trust God, especially in these trying times. this uncertain and challenging time, you can trust God to take care of you.
Be not dismayed, whatever betide, God will take care of you. Beneath his wings of love abide, God will take care of you. God will take care of you through every day or all the way. He will take care of you. God will take care of you. No matter what may be the test, God will take care of you. Lean weary one upon his breast, God will take care of you. God will take care of you through every day or the way. He will take care of you. God will take care of you.
God will take care of you. Isn't that a wonderful message in these troublesome times when so many people are anxious and fearful? We know that God cares, that God loves, that God will take care of each and every one of us. And we want to welcome you to the San Marcos Church. We're grateful for the modern technology that allows us to come inside your homes, inside your houses, and we can worship together. We pray for the time when we can once again meet as a community, but until then, thank God for this opportunity that we have. We pray God's richest blessings upon each and every one of you. We know that there are many people who are hurting and suffering these days. I know that there are people who are anxious and concerned for good reason because their jobs are on the line. They might be laid off. Some of them are medical people, nurses, and others as well. I've heard of all kinds of difficult cases. I heard of this young woman, 24 years old, who has two or three children and on a ventilator machine. I heard of this doctor, an MD from Loma Linda, 30-something years old and has a coronavirus and is in trouble and at great risk. So these are times for us as a community to pray for our own church, pray for our community here at the San Marcos Church. We're continuing the food program every Tuesday, starting around 4:00. We go to around 6:00, but the people start coming in much earlier than that. We have the whole parking lot fills up with cars. Sometimes we've had as many as 250 cars, which represent sometimes more than one family per car. So you can just do the math yourself. This last week it was a little bit less. I don't know if the people got discouraged because of the long lines, but we had at least 175 vehicles that we were putting foods into the back of their trunks in order to be able to be helpful to them. So keep that food program. We've made lots and lots of friends through the food program. Many of these people, at least 60 of them, we are studying the Bible with. Some of them have already finished our Bible course. So God is doing good things, and we've made many, many friends through it. So we pray that you would continue to bless us through your prayers, Thank you so much for your financial help as well. There are people sending in their tithes and offerings. Some of them are putting it in our mailbox. Others are with us online. We appreciate it all. God bless you and keep you. Now, at this time, we have our opening song, which is We Have This Hope. This is a very Seventh-day Adventist belief song put together by one of our own people.
Sabbath. Now is this time, the time where we return our tithes and offerings. And we know right now there's a time, it's a time where people are concerned, but now even more, it's time to have our trust and our faith in our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. So let's remember that we're not to hold back and return our tithes and offerings to the Lord. You can do so by going online. You can also send your tithes and offerings to the church. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, we ask you to bless our tithes and offerings, Lord, your tithes and offerings, Lord. And we ask you, Lord, to help us to keep our trust and our faith in you, dear Father. We ask you this in the precious and awesome name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Good morning, happy Sabbath. Today we're going to talk about habits. What is a habit? A habit is defined as a regular practice, especially one that is hard to give up. Well, how long does it take to form a habit? On average, it takes 66 days for something to become a habit. But some habits can be made in as little as 18 days, while others can take up to 254 days. On the flip side, it can take on average 21 days to break a habit. On March 19th, we were told we should stay home to keep ourselves and others safe. That was 45 days ago. That means we could have created some habits. That also means we could be breaking some habits. But is a habit bad? Yes and no. Creating a good habit or breaking a bad habit are good things, while creating a bad habit people that are bad habits.
We can break habits of eating food that is not healthy for us and create a good habit of eating healthy foods such as fruits and veggies. We can break the habit of sitting on the couch all day watching TV and instead go for a walk and get some fresh air. We can break the habit of playing video games and instead plant in the garden, clean up the yard, or help with other chores throughout the home. We can break the habit of only talking to our friends when we're at church or school and instead reach out and talk to them from within our homes. On days it's too hot or too cold to go outside, we can exercise indoors, but still take some moderate naps. And most importantly, we can continue or create a habit of reading our Bibles and speaking to God every day. In our house, each night, Luke and I read a chapter from his Bible and thank God for the blessings he has given us that day. So let us remember to be positive and keep our good habits, create new good habits, and break the bad habits. And remember to always share a smile.
We want to thank everyone for tuning in and watching today's children's story. If you can, please join me in a word of prayer for our children. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for allowing us to still come together, even in these difficult times. Please be with us to guide us and protect us until we're able to meet together in person as a family. Please guide us during these difficult times to remember to create your good habits and break the bad habits. Thank you for all that you do. Please guide us and protect us in all that you do. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you guys. Hope to see you soon.
Now is going to be time to have the scripture. It's a message from our Bible. If you are able to stand up, please stand up and follow with me. At about 4 o'clock in the morning, Jesus came toward them walking on the water. They were scared out of their wits. "A ghost," they say, crying out in terror. But Jesus was quick to comfort them. "Courage, it's me. Don't be afraid." Peter, suddenly bold, said, "Master, if it's really you, call me to come to you on the water." He said, "Come ahead." Jumping out on the boat, Peter walked on the water to Jesus. But when he looked down at the waves churning beneath his feet, he lost his nerve and started to sink. He cried, "Master, save me." May God add a blessing to the reading of his word. Let us pray now.
Please join us in. If you're able to kneel down at home with prayer with us, please do so. Dear Father in heaven, this prayer scripture, the scripture that we just listened to, helped me to remind of the times that we're going through right now. We need to be more trusting of you and to be more obedient in your word. And with this pandemic going on, it's a good time for us to not fall in that water because of doubt. And please give us the strength and help us to follow you and be obedient and very confident in your word and your promises. There's a lot of people out there, Father, that are hurting because financial matters, people losing their jobs, people getting sick. People are afraid to say hi to each other. Coming close together is almost a thing of the past. Help us to be more kind and caring towards each other, and help us to just trust you, Father, in whatever matters that we have. And there's people out here, people that are looking at us this Sabbath day. We encourage them to call us if they need any help. Get the word out, whoever needs help, that we could help them out. And be with our church leaders to help them lead us in your ways. And be with our government officials to help them follow you so they can make good and clear decisions. Thank you for everything that we have so far, Father. Please continue to bless us and guide us and keep us in your heart. In your Son's most precious name, amen.
Very grateful that we have a very nice special music today. Give them all to Jesus.
Are you tired of chasing pretty rainbows? Are you tired of spinning round and round? Wrap up all the shattered dreams of your life, and at the feet of Jesus lay them down. Give them all. Shattered dreams, wounded hearts, and broken toes. Give them all, give them all, give them all to Jesus, and He will turn your sorrows into joy. He never said you'd only see sunshine. He never said there'd be no rain. He only promised a heart full of singing about the very things that once brought pain.
Praise the Lord. He can turn our sorrows into joy. Isn't that true? Very good. At this time, we are going to have our main speaker, Pastor Dan Smith. It's going to be his second installment on a big God that we have. And we enjoyed last week about the cave, and this week he has another interesting sermon. Pastor Dan Smith and I, we've had the opportunity to do evangelism all over the world. We've gone to very remote places indeed. He's going to talk about this sermon about our time in Tonga. And the Tonga people are, without a doubt, the best singers I've ever heard of anywhere. I mean, it just seems like the whole island was very musical. But in the beginning, they were not that happy to have us there. But little by little, they saw that our motives were good and that we came there to the island to bless them and to be with them and to work alongside of them. And ultimately, they accepted us, and it was a wonderful thing. Another interesting thing about the Tongan people is, wow, they are the best cooks in the whole world. I mean, we got there, and there were literally 2 60-foot tables, not one table, you know, long rows of table, all with food. And then they told us that they didn't even do the red carpet treatment because they didn't think we were that special. It's like, imagine had we been special. Think of what it would have been like then. But we ended up loving these folks and had such a good time. If you have an opportunity to go on mission trips, of course you can go on a mission trip right here in our food bank. That's a wonderful mission trip. But going across the seas and learning to love other people and other cultures, that's a big blessing as well. So thank you, Pastor Dan Smith, for this wonderful message that you're about to give to us. Smith, he is preaching for us a big God sermons, that we have a big God who is able to help us out of all of our difficulties and allow us to do the great things that he wants us to do. Thank you, Pastor Dan, for being with us here at the San Marcos Seventh-day Adventist Church. May God bless you, and may God bless each one of you as you listen to this message.
Well, how are you today? It is an honor to get to be part of San Marcos 2 Sabbaths in a row. How good is that? And to get to be with my brother, Basil, and boy, music and everything is just a special, special treat. And as we said last week, as I was working on a week of prayer for my home church in La Sierra, just the idea that I wanted to talk about a big God. That even though our world is going crazy, most of us have never experienced anything like this. My whole year got wiped out. I had 8 evangelistic series all scheduled, general conference with quiet hour, all gone. And we would have been in Philippines today preaching if this all hadn't happened. And I just needed for myself and for everyone I talked to say, here's a big God. God is a big God. So this was Sabbath a couple of weeks ago in my church. And so let me try this message out on you. I have some friends who are in the Philippines. I assume they're there right now. They have a ministry. He had a helicopter. Now they have some airplanes also. And they would fly their helicopter where no one else can go. You'd have to hike for days. And then maybe put a sick person on the, what they call the skids, underneath. And then fly him to a hospital. His wife's a nurse. Great, great friends of mine. And so somehow this 50-year-old helicopter, they had this guy, he was unconscious, so he didn't know any of this was happening. And they get him all bound up, and they put him on a gurney, and they tied the gurney to the skid. And they fly up there, they're 5,000 feet up in the sky, and the guy wakes up. And he wakes up, and he's under a helicopter, and he looks over to the and he's 5,000 feet up in the sky. And he freaks out. You think what you would do. So somehow he untied himself from what he was in, climbed up the side, opened the door, reaches inside, and tries to take over the wheel and to go down. He wants to get back on solid ground. He does not want to be up there. And the poor pilot, my friend, had to somehow keep the helicopter going and fight this guy off, get him out of the way. Craziness. We all feel better on solid ground. And Jesus came walking on the water. When the disciples saw him, they screamed in terror, thinking he was a ghost. And Jesus said, "It's all right, I am here, don't be afraid." And Peter said to him, "Lord, if it's really you, tell me to come to you by walking on water." And Jesus says, "All right, come." So Peter went over the side of the boat. You've got to get out of the boat and let go of the boat. Jesus says, "Come. Come. Get out of the boat and come." That's the call. God is always calling ordinary people to do extraordinary things. Most of us are ordinary people. I'm ordinary. But God wants us to do extraordinary things, and he says, "Come. Come." For my parents, that was leaving at 28 years old from this conference, Southeastern, South California. I was 4 years old and go to Thailand. Three little boys. Land on a little place in Chiang Mai, Thailand. Wooden crates out in the front yard. My mother said she knew she had about an hour or two to find a stove, open that stove, get kerosene, make fire, make water, boiled water, so we could live. 28 years old, three kids. Jesus says, "Come." For me, I began to be invited to go overseas. How many years ago? 20 years ago? Go preach in Thailand. I was just an ordinary pastor. I did well, I think. Most people thought I was a good pastor. But nothing special. Nothing extraordinary. But God says, "Take me to Thailand, Philippines." We've been going through our pictures. All these memories coming back. Places I've gone around the world. And I remember the first time they called and said, "Pastor Dan from Philippines University said, could you raise $4,500 so we could have a satellite dish for our evangelism for Net 98? A lot of money. I got my own problems here at my church of La Sierra. The president of the Division of India called the same week and said, "Could you raise one for us? $9,000. But over the weekend, God helped me do it. Come. Extraordinary. Let's go. So we built this church in Thailand, many other projects. Begin to preach in front of 1,000 people, 2,000 people, youth congress in the South Philippines, 7,000 people. I'm still scared to death and freaked out every time. You'd think I would get over that, but not yet. And then they said, "You have to make an appeal, Pastor Dan. In my culture, in my world, we have not done much in the way of appeals. So to stand there and say, 'If you would like to give your life to Jesus and get baptized, please come.' I was scared to death. Nobody would come, and here I would be, you know, embarrassed and called out in front of everybody that I can't get anybody to make a decision." Jesus says, "Come. You can do this." When they called and asked me to build this church, $150,000 back then. Scared to death. We finished that. The lady said, can you build an ad building for it? $250,000. Calling ordinary people to do extraordinary things. I watched an interview with Melinda Gates the other day, and you may say she's not extraordinary. I mean, she's extraordinary. She was just an employee at Microsoft. Smart, engineer, yes, but sitting at a table where there was an empty seat and Bill Gates sat at the seat next to her and eventually asked her out and eventually married one of the richest men in the world. I watched her tell the story on Letterman here a few weeks ago on Netflix, and I'm reading her book. I think God came to them and said, "Don't just stay in the boat with all your money and being rich people and your big house. Do something." And she and Bill, 2000, began to start a foundation, Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation, and they go around the world. And now she's writing this book and she's speaking out everywhere. Didn't plan to do that. She says, I'm a private person just raising my three kids. But she felt the burden to do something to fight for women, to fight for children around the world, and has gone everywhere. And they have the resources, and they can just make a disease go away, or they can do powerful things. Come out. Get out of the boat. Three ladies who were in John Ortberg's church up in Menlo Park heard him preach a sermon from the Lord's Prayer, Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. That God wants you to do his kingdom down here. Three ladies came to the pastor and they said, we want to do something for God. What do you want to do? We want to heal all the babies that have HIV in Africa. Like 11 million. John Ortberg said, maybe we should start right here. If you're going to get out of the boat, why don't you do something right here? He said, we live on this side of the freeway and we have rich houses and a beautiful school. But over there, black and Hispanic community is poor, schools, not good. Why don't you do something for that school? Those three ladies went over to that school, found what the needs were. There was no trees, there was no grass, there was no playground equipment. And those three ladies organized and they got Starbucks to help and they raised money. And 100 people went there and they planted grass and they planted, I think, 100 trees. Ordinary people, Jesus, come, let's do something extraordinary. Bruce Wilkinson, who wrote the book Prayer of Jabez and all of that, wrote a book called The Dream Giver. He's sitting at a restaurant with somebody and they said, I think God is a destiny for everybody, a dream for everybody. Yes. Just certain special people, not everybody. He said, let me show you. Call the waitress to come back over. He said, what would you really be doing if you could do whatever your dream was? He said, I'd be a nurse. Why aren't you a nurse? Don't have any money. Got two kids. He said, who could watch the kids for you if you went to school? Well, I suppose my mother could. He said, well, wouldn't they do it? A minute later, they heard her go to the next table. Guess what? I'm going to be a nurse. She had a dream. God calls everybody. Get out of the boat. Come. What's God calling you to do? I'm just ordinary, Pastor Dan. It doesn't mean you have to go do a foundation with billions of dollars. But what does God want you to do to get out of the boat and live by faith and do something for God? What are you going to do to get out of the boat? What's the boat? The boat is whatever makes you feel safe. Whatever makes you feel secure and comfortable. Not out there on the water, walking on water. Are you crazy? For me, it was just pastoring my church. I can do this. I can do this. What makes you feel comfortable? And God says, I want to take you out from there. I want you to preach in front of 1,000, 2,000 people. I want you to raise money. I want you to do things out beyond. You want to make appeals. Stay safe. Don't take a chance. Don't risk. What makes you feel safe? I got involved in casting demons out for a while when we were young. Young pastor in Oregon. I was in my pastor's office like Basil has here. The evangelist was in my church. We had this guy. We laid him on the floor, put his head on a pillow. Four or five of us, middle of the night. I hadn't been out of school very long. I was 25, 26 years old. And all of a sudden, they began to call demons out. I had never done this, and I wasn't exactly sure what was going to happen, so I grabbed the couch. That's my boat. If demons going to come, I was going to hold on to something. A couple nights later, the demons called me on my phone at home, 2:30 in the morning. scared to death. I turned on every light in the house. I opened Bibles up to where Bible verses about Christ triumphing over the demons. I was scared to death. So I held on to whatever boats I could find. I said, Dan, your faith is weak. Don't want to walk on water. I want to keep something safe, under control, keep my feet on the ground. Jesus says, come, get out of the boat. Don't just hold on to what you've always known. For you, it might be money. Don't hold on to your money. Family connections, what you're used to, your habit that you've had all along, whatever is your boat that makes you feel comfortable. Jesus says, come out. Do something new, different. There's always some fear. Can you imagine getting out of a boat and stepping onto water and letting go? Not easy. Not easy. We all want to be on solid ground. Me too. I went to high school in Singapore. My roommate decided to take flying lessons. And for some crazy reason, I decided to go with him on the day that he was learning how to land. He's 16 years old. We did go touch and go. So you fly around and then you come in and land. Oh my, we would hit the ground and bounce up 30, 40 feet in the air. Or we'd be up in there and then land like a rock on the land. After two or three times, I said, help me out. I want to be on solid ground again. I was afraid. I wrote down my top 10 just for fun, but I just began to think the times I have been afraid, the most afraid in my life. And I don't know if these are in any real order, just 10. My youth group at Garden Grove took me to North Berry Farm, and they walked me in, and they put me in something called Accelerator. I never heard or seen it. You sit in this thing, and then all of a sudden, shoot, straight up, then you go over, and then straight down. I'll never do that again. Scared to death. The time I had the demon call at 2:30 in the morning. The time in Chicago when I had a church member who was dying of cancer, and someone loaned him a Porsche that he could drive around just for fun. And the guy thought he should take me for a ride. Well, okay, I'll go with you. He's going on clover leaves off the freeway at 100 miles an hour, and I'm scared to death. I finally realized he doesn't care if he dies. He's going to die in 2 weeks anyway. I want to live still. The time they told me we were going to go scuba diving and scuba dive a wall. Usually you go down 34 feet, Catalina, there's sand there. If you mess up, you're just going to go into sand. But when you dive a wall, it might be 1,000 feet down to the bottom. You mess up. I thought, what if I mess up? Time we went to a snake show out by Chiang Mai, Basel. My brother and I were there. We were on the back row, as far from those snakes as we could go. And they were doing whatever they did. All of a sudden, they had a little stick, and they flicked one, and the snake landed at our feet. I about died of a heart attack. And I looked down, and there was a rope with a knot on the end, scared to death. The time when I was a young adult, and we went up to Half Dome in Yosemite, and we went up to the top holding on to those cables, and you look down, and if you slip, 1,000 feet down. Time I got stung by a bee, I'm allergic to bees, in Thailand, and we were an hour and a half from a hospital, scared to death. A time at 31 when it looked like I might have cancer. Well, how can that happen at 31 years old? A time I stood outside Hilda's apartment with an engagement watch in my pocket, asking her to marry me, wondering if she would say yes or no. And number one, the time I had to stand in front of 1,500 people in my church, and they had never seen me without a hairpiece before, and I had taken it off at 50 years old, and I had to stand before a church and say, will you love me as I am or not? All through the Bible, there are moments of fear before they did something great. Every time, just about every time. You think about them. Noah, go into an ark. They're having a party. The Bible says they're eating, drinking, and making merry. And God says, go into the ark, and you're in the desert 500 miles away from any ocean, and no one has ever seen rain. And you're going to be embarrassed in front of everybody. Walk inside this boat. Moses. Call for the fire. Fear. The priest, and God says, step into the Jordan River. It will open up. No, God, you open it up first, God, then we'll step in. No, there's always this moment of fear. You step in first. And Jehoshaphat, surrounded by enemies. Okay, God, what do you want us to do? Put the choir out in front. Well, that's a good idea, God. That's a real good idea, God. We're surrounded by 180,000 enemies. You want us to go sing to them? You come down and sing, God. And then Jesus himself. Every sin in the world has ever come down on him. Jesus is there and he begs God to let him off. God, I don't want to do this. It's fear of the cross. Fear of losing the Father. He clung to the ground to keep from going any farther out. We all have fear. But you think about it then. That without faith, what gets done? There'd have been no ark, and there'd be no human race anymore after the flood. There'd be no great victory and fire down at the top of the mountain. Jehoshaphat, 180,000 people died. No exodus. Everything good is usually fear and faith involved. Without faith, there'd be no church. No one would build a church. No one would make a song or write a music or do a painting, build projects, do mission trips, build a La Sierra University. I love those moments when they would put all the grades up on the wall or pass out a little piece of paper and he'd be, what did you get? And I would be the number one over and over again. I live for that. I was not tall enough or fast enough to be a great athlete or any of those things. I was okay, but not great. This is the one thing I could be the best at. I had control. I could have the best grades. I was scared to death God would take that away. I was a decent athlete. I was afraid he would take that away. I had a beautiful blonde girlfriend. Scared to death that I would give my life to God. I wanted to stay in the boat, keep everything the way I liked it, comfortable. Jesus says, come on out. Turned out he didn't take any of that away. But he had to break that hold on me. Get me to break this idea, to hold on to what is comfortable and what is safe. And he's had to do that over and over and over again in my life. Because I want to keep what is safe. But money we have, my house, my life, my job, my work, my church, why go take chances? Go out and walk on water. Want to stay safe. Anyway, how do you learn to walk on water? I suppose we start by remembering what God has already done. When you see what God has done in the past, you'll say, okay. You think what Peter has already seen. Peter's already seen blind man to see. Peter's already seen people, God do fantastic miracles, change water to wine, cast demons out of people, feed 5,000 people. So it starts with remembering what God has already done. You say he's done it for them, maybe he can do it for you too. I'm always blessed. God doesn't have to do a miracle for me, but I'm blessed by other people's miracle stories. And then I know that he can do it for me too. Peter does not have to be some Billy Graham, some Mark Finley, some giant and superstar. But if God can get Peter to walk on water, then I can walk on water. Then I can do something, and I can go preach, and I can make appeals, and I can raise money. If God can do it for Peter, he can do it for me. The question is always, do you trust him? That's always where the battle ends up being for me. trust him. I had a lady get a hold of me a few years ago, wanted to support my mission project. I'd never met her. She just listened to me on the radio. I eventually did meet her a couple times. And over the years, she gave me a lot of money for various church projects and schools around the world, Thailand, Vietnam, Philippines. Never went with me. She said, this is what God wants me to do. She had some stock that someone had given to her, and she used it all for God. And I can show you pictures and stories. She was amazing. I came back from one trip, and I called her to thank her for what she had done and tell her about a couple more needs that had just come up on that trip. And her sister-in-law got on the phone and said, Pastor Dan, yes, I'm so sorry to tell you, she's passed away. Oh, I said to a couple of my friends who go with me all the time, I don't know what will happen. And he said, Pastor Dan, God is not going to stop. I was having a hold on to the boat moment. God is not going to stop and forget about us. God is still going to help us, Pastor Dan. I have to remind myself all the time. Some of you may be watching this basketball stories every Sunday night now, tomorrow night again on ESPN. Story of Michael Jordan. I was in Chicago during all those years. I know these people. I've watched this. It came down to one of these great famous games, Michael Jordan and John Paxson. John Paxson was a 6'2 guard. He still now is working for the Bulls. White guy, good shooter, but didn't. None of the athletic ability that Michael Jordan had. They're in the fourth quarter of the last game of the playoffs. And Michael Jordan is frustrated because he keeps passing the ball to his teammates and they're not making it. So he's trying to take it over himself and going 1-5 and they're losing. And they called timeout. And Phil Jackson, the coach, said to Michael Jordan, who's open, Jordan? Who's open? Because they're doubling and tripling you. And Jordan said, Paxson, yes, trust him. Give him the ball. And Michael Jordan would drive in and everyone would collapse on him and he would kick it out to Paxson. And Paxson made shot after shot after shot. Scored 20 points in the fourth quarter and they won the championship. You trust God. Get out of the boat and walk to the water. Walk. Obviously, we have to keep your eyes on Jesus. Every time I have sunk, it's because you take your eye off Jesus. How many times God asked me to do something that I really don't want to do? It's beyond my normal ability to do it. I'll stay in the boat. And we begin to throw out the reasons. God, too much money. Don't have that much money, God. Take your eye off Jesus, we sink. Never done it that way before. Don't think that'll work. Never heard about anyone doing that. Not good enough. I think it's going to rain. Negativity. Stay on the boat. No more eyes on Jesus. Over and over again. When I am timid and I don't want to go do something great for God, God says, come out. And you begin to think about all the reasons why that's not going to work. And if it's not my own voice, it's just negative people around me in a church, wherever it is. Not you, I'm sure. Almost everywhere there's somebody that says something negative. Can't do that. Years ago, I was in a conference far away. And I let someone from the conference get inside my head. I had been a good pastor, successful pastor, and baptized a lot of people, gone around the world. But somehow this person was not happy with what I thought I was doing, the path I was going, wanted me to become something else. And I allowed that voice of negativity, always little jokes, little digs, little remarks, to get inside my head. And it came a time where I could hardly preach, hardly do anything. because I'd let that voice get inside my head. And I said to Hilda, I got to get this voice out of my head. I can't have that voice in me to flourish again and be able to do things. But you cannot allow people and negative voices. Jesus says, come out. And if we keep our eye on him, we will walk on water and we will do extraordinary things for the glory of God. Did Jesus pick him up and carry him back to the boat, or did Peter ever walk on water? I think it's pretty clear that eventually he did walk on water. And Ellen White says that he walked on water. And so I'm just going to put it out there and say, I believe that everybody needs to walk on water and live by faith if you're going to be saved. We are saved by faith and not by works. You don't have to be a Christian to be in the boat. Non-Christians can be in the boat, no faith. Christians make money, non-Christians make money. Christians play sports, non-Christians play sports. Christians make love, non-Christians make love. That's in the boat. You can do those things without having any faith, without your eye on Jesus at all. You'll never have faith. You'll never walk on water. What makes us different is that we leave the boat and we walk to Jesus to go be where Jesus is out on the water. Walk to Jesus. Peter walked on water with Jesus. So I'm going to say that everyone who's going to be saved is going to walk on water. At some point, we are saved by faith. And we will walk on water. And we will let go of control. And if I can say this, Basil, whoever's out there listening, the difference between an average, ordinary Christian Adventist life and a life where you flourish, where you begin to take off, is to get out of the boat and walk to Jesus. When you begin to say, okay, I'm gonna risk it and go on the adventure and I'm going to live. And I can just tell you story after story after story in my life where that has added richness and depth and meaning to my life. All the way through the Bible. It says someday there will be a group of people seem to be a sea of glass. This is before the Armageddon. This is before the seven last plagues. These are people who are so committed to Jesus. They are so sealed to Jesus, fully devoted to Jesus. Jesus is everything to them. Their eyes are on Jesus. In fact, it says they follow the Lamb wherever he goes. Even though they are still here, they are walking on water in heaven, walking on a sea of glass today. Are you? Are you still in the boat? And Jesus says, come on, let's live by faith. Let's go live an extraordinary life with Jesus. A little farther. How are we going to go to heaven? Everybody knows we're going to go in a cloud. Revelation 14, 13. Then I saw a white cloud, and seated on the cloud was the Son of Man. He comes the size of a man's hand, and we're going to go on a cloud. You know that. What's a cloud? Air and water. How are you going to walk on a cloud? Because your eyes are on Jesus. Everyone is going to be saved. He's going to go in a cloud and walk on water because their eyes are on Jesus. Best picture I could find, walking on a cloud. Now let's go to the gospel. How are we saved? By the cross. It is by the cross, and by the cross what? Alone. It is finished, Jesus. We're going to be saved by cross alone. For I determined to know nothing among you except Jesus Christ and him crucified. You have to get out of the boat completely. You cannot hold on to the boat and be saved by the cross at the same time. It's all Jesus. The famous Reformation essentials, saved by grace alone, through faith alone, in Christ alone, Scripture alone. It's all alone, alone, alone. You can't mix it. Rick Rice had the idea. I'm sorry, here's some more of the verses. Whatever is not of faith is sin. It is impossible to please God without faith. That is all by faith. You cannot mix faith and works on this point. We do want to live works. Yes, we do. But not to be saved. Not one bit of it. My friend Richard Rice teaches at Loma Linda now. He was at La Sierra for so long. He said, you say you got some terrible cancer surgery, something you're going to need. Let's say the bill is $200,000. And you can't do that. That is far beyond any resources you have. Rich man comes along and says, I feel sorry. I'll pay it. I'll pay it all. $200,000. You can do, oh, thank you. But I don't want you to feel like you have to do it all, you know. Let me give you something. And you whip out $20 bill and let me chip in $20. I don't want you to feel like you have to do it all. Let me do part of it. I'll share it with you. It's ridiculous. When Jesus does it all and Jesus dies on a cross, you and I cannot be showing up with $20. Here's my little Sabbath keeping. Here's my little, I took some food out to some people Sabbath afternoon. It is by faith, and it is by faith alone and the cross alone. And you got to get out of the boat, and you got to let go of the boat and go to Jesus and trust Jesus alone. That's how we're saved, by Jesus alone. It is finished. And we be very clear about that. And Ellen White says clearly, there is no room for fear. Faith has no room for fear. All faith. All faith. Well, last question. Is the exhilaration of walking on water worth the risk of failure? Peter's standing here on the edge of the boat. If I walk on water, it's going to be exciting, but I could crash. Is it worth it? Is it worth it? We're all scared. Scared we'll mess up. Scared we'll drown in front of everybody. Me too. Every project I do, I'm scared. Every sermon, still frightening to me after 45 years. Every time I make an appeal, every time I got to raise money, those are all chances to mess up. You land on the airport and they tell me, Pastor Dan, we're going to baptize 600 people tomorrow and there's no churches. We need 9 churches tomorrow, Pastor Dan. Where am I going to get 9 churches? But God helped me raise the money for those 9 churches. You come down, you finish one sermon, and say, Pastor Dan, can you come down the hallway and give another talk to the Bible class? And you have them here to the class to come up with something for 45 minutes. And gradually you learn. God will come through. Gradually you learn. Money will come through. And you have these moments that are just thrilling when you're out on the water and God comes through for you. And those moments when you let go of the boat and you begin to walk on water to Jesus, they become the moments of your life. They define your life. The rest of the moments, the broccoli, eating ordinary food, it's the ice cream. These are the moments of ice cream. They define your life. They are the ones that go into the photo album. They are the ones that you remember when you look back at your life. They are the moments when you got out of the boat and walked on water. I'm glad I didn't pass up that call when Jesus asked me, go preach, go raise money, go do that, go see those people, talk to them. And they are what makes life rich. Those times when you face the fear and you do it anyway and say, okay, I'm going to go. You go water skiing. You're in the boat. And someone says, you want to try it? Okay, I'll try it. And you get out of the boat and they give you a ski. And you struggle to get that ski on. And they give you a rope. And you say, hit it. And they pull you up. And eventually you're on the water and you are water skiing. You're walking on water. And you get to feel one of the greatest feelings in the world is to be on the water. You're on top. gliding on water. And God says, if you'll just get out of the boat and come, I will fill your life with moments that are indescribable. And the exhilaration of living with God and doing God's things with Him, with Jesus out on the water, has given me everything that's meaningful in my life. Basil, you agree with this? How many times we've done this? How many times Basil has come to me on our trips and said, Pastor Dan, can we do this? Can we do that? Where's the money? I don't know. Okay, let's do it. Let's just do it. And we go. And there's a church. And I fly back to Thailand and I do a week of prayer in a church that we helped build. And they said, we're going to have a baptism. We have 12 who made the decision. Pastor Dan, you can do the baptism. And I go back into the baptistry and I'm baptizing people in the water where I built the church in honor of my father. And they put orchids in the water. And I'm baptizing people in a tank filled with orchids. And I said, God, you are good. Because I got out of the boat and went to Jesus. It's always worth it. Last point. One of the issues in all world religions is who knows how to be the most human. We're human. And every religion tries to claim to say, we are the ones. You want to know what humanity really is like and how to be the most human, the most alive? It's us. So Confucius, he said it was by following all the rules of life. He says, who you are, you're this kind of person, you're a father, okay, that's your role. You follow your role. Mother, you are your child, you follow your role. You're the servant, you're old, you're a warrior, you're a shopkeeper. Follow these rules and society, and you will be the most human. What they call the way or Lao Tzu, he came and said, no. That is not how you are the most human. If you're the most human, if you break away from all those rules and roam around, people would just leave and be gone for weeks and months, and you roam free and get back in touch with nature, that is when you are the most human. Every religion. What do we believe? That God made us in His image. We are made in the image of God. And then Jesus comes down here and He shows us what humanity is supposed to be. And if you want to be human, the most alive, what do you need to do? Get out of the boat and walk to Jesus. And when you are with Jesus, you will be the most human, the most alive, the most awake, the most electric. It's because you're out there on the water with Jesus. And the boat is not being fully human. It's when you go to be with Jesus and you begin to listen and be Jesus, you will find your humanity and be the best you can possibly be. In athletics, we call it being in the zone. Jesus walked on water. In sports, we call it being in the zone. Flow. People write books about flow. When you've got it. It's just you've got it. I was 40 years old. I've been playing intramurals with kids in the school for 20 years. I was in Chicago. I'm getting ready to move from Chicago to La Sierra. That's probably the last intramural game I probably ever played. Old now. And I went down to the Hinsdale Academy to play with my guys. And somehow I got it. It just came back. I couldn't miss. I shot everywhere, all over the court. And the magic had come back. And all the kids went home to their parents. Parents told me, "Late, Pastor Dan, you should have seen Pastor Dan today, what he did." I was in the zone. Once in a while, you get the magic. Golf or sports, preaching, you can be in a zone. And you just know you are with God and you're walking on water. You left the boat and you're out on magic land. Times when you know you're hearing the voice of God and you know you're doing it with God and you're doing something with God, for God, with Jesus, for His glory. And you're in the zone. It's the best. Let me finish with one little quick thing I just heard yesterday. Walt Disney's daughter wrote a book. Usually when people write a book about someone famous, they tear them down. They reveal all the human side. But in this case, she loved her father, thought he was great. But evidently, she didn't really know who he was. She just knew it was her father, and he was great. And she went to a classroom thing at the school, and somehow at the class they were talking about Walt Disney and Disneyland and the movies, and it was her father. And she went home, and she went to her father. He's reading the newspaper, and she pulled the newspaper away, and she put her hands on his face, and she said, "You never told me you were Walt Disney." She didn't know who her father was. And I just want to say, this is who our Father is. And he is the Father who made us not to be in the boat, but to walk on the water and to trust him and have our eyes on him. And if you'll go out there, we will find out life as it's supposed to be. And if you're still sitting in a boat, I encourage you today to hear the Spirit. Whatever God is calling, come to you today. Go. Go. And you will find life. Bible says if you lose it, you will find it. And may you find life out on the water, walking with Jesus. Thanks for letting me be with you. God be with you. He's a big God. Amen.
Thank you so much, Pastor Dan Smith. We really appreciate it. To step out of the water and do something. Once again, we want to thank you so much for being with us today. We want to thank all those who helped us with the service, with the Sabbath school class, with scripture reading, prayer, and all the music. We appreciate each and every one of you. We pray God's richest blessing upon you, and if you enjoyed the service, make sure you share it with others. Go to our sanmarcossda.com, and you'll find us there, and put a share with all your friends so it can go far and wide. God bless you. We'll see you again. If you need anything, remember to let us know about your needs so that we can do our very best to make that possible for you. Maybe you need some food, somebody to go to the grocery store for you. Whatever it is, give us a call. And you can call our church number, 760-744-9777. That will then hook you up to our other calls, and we'll make sure that whatever you need, we can help you with. Remember our food program every Tuesday. We know that there are programs all over the county. Juan Hidalgo was telling me about one that he's helping with down in Chula Vista. If there ever was a time when people need help, it is certainly now. So we're very grateful that we have an opportunity to do that. God bless you once again. Have a happy Sabbath. Go out for a walk with your family and friends. I guess you can't go to the beach, but maybe you can find some other place to go to. Blessings to you, and we'll see you again very, very soon.